Distinguished guests and fellow colleagues, welcome to today's CLC lecture series in collaboration with the National Parks Board. My name is Ing Shan, and I'm from the Centre for Liveable Cities. The Centre for Liveable Cities, or CLC, is a knowledge centre jointly established by MND and MUA in 2008. Our mission is to distill and create and share knowledge on livable and sustainable cities. The centre's work spans three main areas: research, capability development, and promotions. The CLC lecture series provides a platform for urban thought leaders and experts to exchange ideas and share knowledge. Today's lecture is part of the CLC Urban Pioneer Lecture Series, where we hope to share Singapore's urban development expertise and experience over the past 40 to 50 years. This year, 2013, marks a very important occasion, 50 years of greening Singapore. In 1963, then Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew planted a mempat tree at Farrer Circus, signifying the start of our greening campaign. Today, we are honoured to have with us a distinguished panel consisting of greening and biodiversity conservation experts to share their insights on this topic. We have Dr. Chua Sian Eng, the former Commissioner of the Parks and Recreation Department of Singapore's Ministry of National Development, Dr. Shawn Lum, President of Nature Society Singapore, and Mr. Poon Hong Yuen, Chief Executive Officer of the National Parks Board. The lecture would be moderated by Professor Neo Boon Siong, former Dean of the Nanyang Business School. Each panelist will be making a 10-minute presentation, starting with Dr. Chua, followed by Dr. Lum, and lastly, Mr. Poon. After which, we will have a panel dialogue hosted by Prof. Neo, and the lecture will end with a moderated question and answer session with the audience. With this, let us start the session by inviting Dr. Chua Sian Eng on stage. Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Well, the Garden City campaign started in 1963 with the Prime Minister, the former Prime Minister, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, inaugurated with Tree Planting Day. And he had planted trees at every Tree Planting Day since that time. And the whole idea of this greening campaign was to make Singapore into so that the during urbanization and industrialization of Singapore, that the trees are cut for development will be replaced in the proper manner, because he doesn't want Singapore to be a concrete jungle. So the Parks and Recreation Department was formed in 1974, and the first commissioner was Mr. Wong Yu Kwan, and he carried out the work. And in 1983, when he retired, I took over. And we continued to do the greening by aggressively planting and also to develop the parks so that the Singaporeans can enjoy to go to these places in their spare time. And we also was interested to plant trees along the roadside to provide shade for the people, people who commute in buses, so that they do not walk in the hot sun. And the Prime Minister at that time was very keen to see that a lot of trees, shade trees, were planted, so that people can enjoy a cool walk. And especially in parks, we developed various type of parks for the Singaporeans to enjoy. Because we also, for example, like in Pasir Ris, we developed the children's park so that the family on weekends can bring their children to enjoy the outdoors. And we also did some conservation work in the sense that in Pasir Ris, we had the mangrove, and we conserved that area. And so that became a place where school children can go and look at the marine life in that area. And the Sungai Api Api was, we replant the mangrove to create the, so that the mangrove can thrive there, and so that the marine life can thrive also. In the 1981, I think, besides the parks, in order to connect the parks, Dr. Lee Seng Kong and I published a book called More Than a Garden City in 1992, and we tried to connect all the parks so that the Singaporeans can not only go from one park to another by jogging or cycling. And we also developed so-called long grass areas whereby we want the bird life also to thrive. And we did plant along these park connectors and with the fruit-bearing trees, shrubs like melastoma and the common cherry trees. And also the long grass area was left so that insects can thrive, so some of the birds can feed on the insects. So we also introduced some birds like the magpie robin in the protected areas like the Istana and the Botanic Gardens, because they were depleting in number, because some of the days they were captured for to put in cages by the locals, and the numbers were decreasing. So we had an ornithologist by the name of Chris Hale, and he did introduce a few pairs of this magpie robin in Singapore, and now they are all thriving very well, and you can hear them singing in the morning and in the evening. Besides the park connectors were also used for the, we plant along the, so that people, when they want to go from one park to another, they need not go to the main, use the main road, and they can, at present, I think the National Parks Board has developed more park connectors, especially in Punggol. I think you can see that the development in, it was done in such a way that you have the waterways being incorporated into the park corridors. So the park connector idea was in fact a very good idea to connect all the parks and the people can enjoy them. So in 1981, the Prime Minister initiated the fruit tree planting in the government institutions and in schools. So his whole idea was to inculcate social discipline, because he did tell me, he said when he went to Greece or to Japan, he did notice that a lot of these fruit trees along the roadsides, like persimmons and oranges in Greece, they were never stolen. So he wanted to have the same idea to plant these fruit trees, especially in housing estates, so that people will not steal them. But anyway, that one didn't go that well because in the end, a lot of the fruits were dropped and they not well coordinated by the RCs. But you still have some of the fruit trees still left in the housing estates. And also, Dr. Goh was also interested, and he did tell me to coordinate the fruit tree planting in camps, which I think a lot of the, he wanted the GD, the general duties people, to work and do some work to maintain the fruit trees. And we did plant, like in the Amokui camp, in the missile site, the pineapples and also a kranji. I also helped him to build 1 acre of hydroponic farms to produce vegetables, which they did, and supply their camps with the vegetables that were produced. So, and in order to for the Prime Minister to know the progress of the Garden City campaign, the Garden City Action Committee was formed in 1973, I think. And I think a chair by the Permanent Secretary of Ministry of National Development. And the minutes of the monthly meeting was sent to him, and I think he read every bit of it to see the progress of the greening campaign. And in 1980, I think the Prime Minister was he did say that he expect by 1990, Singapore, and I quote, "Singapore can become a green, shady city filled with fruits and flowers, a city worthy of an industrious people whose quest progress is matched by their appreciation of beauty of nature. The harshness of tarmac and concrete can be softened by natural trees, flowers, and birds." Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon. It's wonderful to see so many friends and also new faces here today. I want to thank Mr. Ku Teng Chai actually for inviting me to participate in this lecture. When I saw the email at first, I thought, no, you got to be kidding. Look at these VIP type people that he's asking me. So it's frightening, but at the same time, an honor and a privilege. Dr. Chua is the mentor of my mentor, Professor Lee Sing Kong. So again, to share the stage with you, it's quite a privilege. And so I thought, well, since we're in that vein, I thought I'd make a confession. My first encounter with the Garden City came in 1989. I joined as a visitor the botany department at the National University, and my mentor there was the late Professor Swan Keng. And Professor Keng said, I was here to study some mangroves. So he said, you're interested in mangroves. And I won't try to replicate his accent. That's very difficult to do. But he said, oh, you're interested in mangroves? I said, yes, I am. He said, well, here, take this number and call it. And it says Lee Sing Kong and Yeo Meng Tong. So I called, and Yeo Meng Tong was a young landscape architect, just came back from NUS. And I said, this is great. I'm going to learn about mangroves. It's, you know, good fit with my topic. It's going to fast forward my, it's going to help me in the learning curve. Then I found out actually they needed somebody to describe mangrove animals, and I'm a botanist, and I knew, still know nothing, but then I even knew less about animals. So for about 2 months, I read every book, learned how to identify what's an insect, what's a snail, what's a fish, this is a crab, and actually for those of you, now you know, if you've been to Pasir Ris, the signboards thankfully are gone now, but all those signboards of animals, the birds of the mangrove, nighttime in the mangroves, I don't know if anybody saw those. I confess it was me, and I apologize for that. But then I already realized, the commitment to trying not only to make something beautiful and to preserve a bit of heritage, but try to share that with others. And I know that many of you in this audience, I see Rosalind Tan, I see so many people who do it so much better than me. I just wanted to talk to you about my own impressions in terms of how the people sector, the NGO sector, have interacted with the various agencies in helping, do our part in trying to achieve a garden city. And along our city in a garden as it is now, and along the way, where is there synergy, and where, to be honest, sometimes there have been the occasional difference of opinion. So and hopefully that contributes to a better place for all of us and for nature as well. So these are the four things that I'd like to talk about. So here's something from URA and NParks. The idea is to get people to participate in this city in a garden. I mean, not just to make something nice for everyone, but something that we all take part in actively. And I represent the Nature Society. We are 60 years old next year, and we have about 1,500 members. We actually had our start in an even older group. We were a regional group called the MNS, Malayan Nature Society. Today it's spun off as the Malaysian Nature Society. And the way the MNS was set up was that there were a number of regional and autonomous groups, of which we were the Singapore branch. And our members, our founders, include some very eminent naturalists, the late philanthropist, Dr. Lok Wan To, for example, and some of the most famous biologists in the region. And to think that I sit on this thing and all these famous people came before me was quite intimidating. We split in 1992, becoming the Nature Society, and this is an interesting thing, I think, even with the MNS, which is we started as a hobby group in the colonial era, bird watchers, people who studied plants, described orchids and everything. We weren't a conservation group from the beginning, and we only kind of accidentally almost became conservation oriented when these places that people were bird watching and looking at butterflies started kind of disappearing. And so this is kind of the split identity we still today, in my opinion, try to come to grips with. What are we? Are we a hobby group? Are we an advocacy group? Are we a watchdog? Are we an education group? And we try to do all of the above. Let me share with you a few areas where we have worked and sometimes come into conflict with various different architects of the city in a garden. First of all, in terms of planning and policy, one of the things that I'm very happy to say we made a small contribution is in 1990, my colleagues Clive Briffitt and Ho Hua Chu put together what they call the Master Plan for Nature Conservation. I realize there's something in front of me, I don't have to keep turning. Master Plan for the Conservation of Nature in Singapore, and those sites that they recommended for setting aside because of their conservation value, some of those got incorporated into Singapore's first draft of the Green Plan, which was presented at Rio in 1992 and revised was presented in Johannesburg in 2002. And another area, I think the story is oft told, that members of the Nature Society, by mistake, stumbled, got lost, possibly. If Richard Hale's in the audience, he may disagree, because he was the person who stumbled upon this area called Sungai Buloh. It wasn't a very popular birding site then. I think then we would go to Sunoco and other places on the north coast. And it turns out that was a very rich place for migratory bird life. And Dr. Chua was there. He, with Parks and Recreation, would know the story better than I, but eventually this dialogue eventually led to the creation of what was called the Sungai Buloh Nature Park under the Parks and Recreation Department, today the Sungai Buloh Wetland Reserve. And to say, you know, to say that an NGO played a small part in making this happen makes me very proud to be associated with the movement. And so there's Sungai Buloh, an aerial view. A few other things that we do. We work with friends at National Parks on something called the Butterfly Trail at Orchard to try to enliven the shopping experience, where you can maybe, if you want to cool down, you don't want to make sure that you don't spend too much money, go out, look at some butterflies, calm down a bit, then maybe go back into the fray, perhaps, you know. But there is, you know, we've managed with NParks to double the butterfly diversity in 3 years, just by planting a few butterfly gardens. And again, we turn to people like Rosalind Tan at Khoo Teck Puat Hospital for advice. How do you make that happen? Another thing, working with the URA, NParks, the railway corridor, to make it something that all Singapore can be proud of for its heritage, in terms of history, nature, as a unique and endearing landmark. We also collect and share data. Some of the work that we've done as part of a consortium organized by National Parks in the early 90s was to contribute to the first survey of the catchment area. So some of us looked at birds, others looked at vertebrates, but essentially that led to the first survey published in 1997 of the Central Catchment Nature Area. Currently, we're also doing a monitoring of the Ecolink area in coordination with NParks, either side of the BKE, looking at animal diversity before, during, after construction of the Ecolink. So there's a data sharing thing that we do too. You know, we are many eyes and ears, and hopefully we can contribute to a national effort. What are some of the challenges? I tried to think about this, and I don't want to take too much time, but really quickly, I think when we talk about garden city to city and a garden, I think one of the things perhaps that one needs to think about is what is one's concept of a garden? And I think maybe looking at it in that context, that could explain some of these differing views. Some people want a nice manicured garden, others want a traditional, say, English style, a Victorian garden. My colleagues want something that's maybe a little bit on the wild side. So here's a map produced as part of the Parks and Water Body Plan showing the parks and nature reserves on the island. Now, if I show you a Google Earth image, you'll see that, well, again, what's the garden? I guess there's some intervening slides. This is the original Singapore, all forest, mangrove, freshwater swamp. Within 60 years of the discovery of Singapore by the British, well, not discovery, colonization by the British, it had been discovered much earlier, obviously, but the nature areas had dwindled. There was very little, much less greenery than today, far less. 7% of the natural forest, everything else had been cleared for agriculture, perhaps. And we're down to these four nature reserves, which include Bukit Timah, Labrador, Sungai Buloh, Central Catchment. Thank you for saving me, Mr. Poon. Nervous, you know. And by the way, Labrador was not safe for the marine life. It was actually first set aside for this unusual fern, championed by the late Professor Holtum, who also was the guy who brought to you Van der Mist Joachim. So again, here's the map. Here's the Google Earth image. You can see there's a lot more green in this than the official parks and water bodies. And the reason is there's a lot of area outside of NParks jurisdiction that's green. So that could be the military area, it could be abandoned kampongs awaiting development in the future. And there's a lot of wildlife in some of these areas outside of the NParks area. Now these are earmarked for development. So then the question becomes, how do we, well, we don't have to, but is there any way to mesh these views of what is a garden? What kind of garden do we want to live in to achieve both a biodiverse, rich ecosystem that's functions in many beneficial ways for us and for animals, as well as developing and making this city something that the whole world looks to? And I guess that, to me, is the challenge, and that's how once in a while occasional differences of opinion arise, such as historically, there was Marina South in the early 90s, which is today where Gardens by the Bay is, and more recently, Bukit Brown. And you can see it's a very green area, but it is earmarked for development. I make no bones about it. But because of its proximity to the nature reserve above, Lorne Road in the middle and Bukit Brown below, it just has happened to become a haven for wildlife. Some rare birds that come out of the forest to Bukit Brown, Kalugo actually flew across Lorne Road, presumably because it's there, and even rare butterflies. And so the question is, in the context of this overall greenery, a lot of people get very passionate about Bukit Brown because it does have a considerable conservation value. And the irony is that the reason why this road had to be routed through the Bukit Brown Cemetery is because the alternative would have been to actually eat into the nature reserve. So it was kind of, between a rock and a hard place. And unfortunately, I think some elements of that difference of opinion got out of hand a little bit, to say the least. But still, the question remains, can we have a development and have greenery and have something that at least manages to, if you talk about nature as a stakeholder, appease the various stakeholders involved. There's a new thing. Sometimes we're redundant. Residents will go and make their concerns known even without NGOs. So for example, residents of Brattle or Pasir Ris or Dairy Farm. Now, I guess the last thing I wanted to say, and hopefully we can address some of these others during the issues during the dialogue, is that, where do I see individually and also as a member of an NGO the way forward in terms of the development of the city in a garden? So I guess there are different ways of doing it. One was to see the garden in a kind of broad and integrated sense, a very holistic system that has services, not just nice and decorative. And I think Dr. Chua already was saying that early on Parks and Recreation went beyond just making shade, making the city comfortable. They were actually trying to bring in wildlife as early as the 1980s, very early in his tenure as commissioner of parks. Can we take this further to bring in some of the services that ecosystems provide and calculate that and integrate that into the concept of the city in the garden? Can we think of this continuum of nature area to urbanized area and actually plan that continuum in a strategic and systematic way? Is that possible? Can we develop a new generation of people who love nature, know horticulture, are real experts, and then can share that with the rest of Singapore and beyond? And I guess the idea of a city in a garden is not something that's just pretty, not something that's this wonderful concept, but something that we all kind of, that it kind of makes the migration, it kind of lodges itself somewhere in here, that we know it, we feel for it, and we're going to do each, in our own way, something to make it even better. I do believe that there's enough convergence between the people sector and the public sector to really make this a garden that benefits both people and nature, and I'd love to talk to you a bit more about it during the dialogue. And again, thank you to the Center for Liveable Cities for allowing me to participate in today's forum. Thank you.
Consuming my water in advance. Thank you very much for inviting NParks to sort of share our view of what is city in the garden, what is a garden city, and so on. I think we are a little bit behind time, so I will make up for lost time. I promise. So, city in the garden. It's a famous photograph. By the way, we found that this was the only photograph in the 1960s of Mr. Lee planting a tree. We tried to look for this 1963, we tried to look for 64, 65, all the way to 70, we couldn't find anything. Even SPH didn't have anything. So this photograph is actually very precious. So in 1963, he planted this tree and set Singapore along the path, along the journey towards Garden City. And I think by and large, I don't think we're being too modest to say that we have achieved this vision. If you ask most tourists what is Singapore's brand name, I think they won't say it's a food paradise or a shopping paradise. Actually, most of them would say we are a garden city. And I think we have earned that very nice name, and we should be very proud of it. And I think Singaporeans in general are very proud of it, because we survey Singaporeans every 2-3 years, and we found that more than 70-80% of them are actually proud to be for Singapore to be identified as a garden city. And also 70-80% of them feel that nature and greenery are important. Parks are important, nature is important, even if they don't visit parks and nature areas. So the sense of identity for Singaporeans as a garden city is very strong. So now we're going towards a city and a garden. Some people, including Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, say it's a play of words. We like to think that it actually is a 2-3 notch, at least, improvement over the garden city. Because we wanted to signify that we can do a lot better. We should not be just satisfied with being a garden city, because many cities in the world, in the region, want to be a garden city. We should remember that we were the original garden city, and to do better than many of these expiring garden cities, we should aim to be much better. And I think we can do it. But I would like to say, first of all, that the city in the garden vision is only possible because of the great work that pioneers like Dr. Chua, Dr. Wong Yu Kwan, and the giants before us, the work that they've put in place, the foundation that they've built for the garden city. Because if you think about it, many cities, if you can think, I don't want to mention names, right? But if you can imagine cities which are very concrete, very built up. Even if today they wake up, they say, oh, collectively we want to be a garden city. Actually, there's no way they can do it because it's already set. The hardware is already set, and the hardware is also set. You know, the journey that we took in 50 years is not just in the hardware, the planting, the infrastructure. It's also the mindset change, you know, the mindset that evolved over 5 decades. In the beginning, my colleagues who've been around, and maybe Dr. Chua can verify that, people actually complained about trees, you know. Why do we plant this tree in front of my house? The leaves are dropping, you know, I have to sweep the leaves so often, they clog up the drains and mosquitoes and so on and so forth. We still have some complaints like that. And if you cast your mind back to 1963, actually, Singapore has no right to dream of being a garden city. We didn't have enough jobs, not enough housing, not enough food, you know, but Mr. Lee sort of, I always say, if we had Facebook back then, maybe we wouldn't have had a garden city, because people would be criticizing the government for daring to do something like that when we didn't even have food and clean water and housing and so on. But we did it. We did it. And I think it's over the years, and now today, just now I mentioned that people complain about trees. Today, if we cut down trees, even for good reasons, people will complain. And to us, those are very good complaints, because it shows that people have accepted that it is a very important part of our identity. Now, city in the garden, I won't sort of go through our 6 strategic thrusts and our 20 initiatives and so on and so forth. But I think suffice to say there are 3 key pillars to the city in the garden. If you ask me what it means, I'll say that we're looking at a city with pervasive greenery. Okay, I'll explain a little bit more about these 3 things in a while. We need to be a city with very rich biodiversity, and also a garden which is sort of owned by the community. Let me share a little bit more. Now, as I said, our city in the garden dream is built upon foundations of the garden city. So on the left, you see that we have built sort of basic parks, very nice parks, parks that people enjoy, do exercises and so on. But we thought, why not take it another level or two? So Dr. Chua, he mentioned Pasir Ris Park. I don't know how many of us are old enough to remember when the big playground in Pasir Ris Park was open. I remembered that the parents from all over Singapore, not just Pasir Ris, would bring their children to Pasir Ris Park to play in that super duper playground. And it's sort of a destination in itself. So we thought, why don't we have more of these? So it's not a totally new idea, but it is a concept that we really want to develop. And if you think about Bishan Ang Mo Park today, the one with the meandering river, again, it is sort of a destination park because parents want to bring their children there to play in the river, to experience the biodiversity there, to learn about the biodiversity there. So this is what we want. And these three parks we have identified as destination parks. So just give you an example. Jurong Lake Park, it's next to Jurong Lake. So a problem with Jurong Lake Park is that the water table is actually very high. So when it rains, you get water ponding or flooding, whatever you call it. Now, it's more ponding than flooding. So the usual thing to do would be to sort of solve the problem by putting earth on it and sort of raising the ground and so on. But we thought, why not make use of that terrain issue? Carve out islands next to the lake and create what we call Thousand Island Adventure Playground. So what you see in the picture, the top, is supposed to be that, right? Flying fox, bridges, and all that for you to do island hopping for the children, but I suppose adults can also play. Admiralty Park, similar issue, well, also a terrain issue, because if you go there, it's a very hilly park, right? So not very much you can do there, but we thought, why not carve big slides into the slopes so that it will be a slides wonderland. And in fact, we're thinking some of the slides may be so big and so wide that the whole family can hold hands and slide down together. So ought to be very exciting. East Coast Park, in many ways, already a destination park. It has, I think, more than 10 million visits a year, just to put it in context. It's the biggest and most popular park in Singapore. But funnily enough, there's no playground in East Coast Park. I don't know whether you realize. So we want to build a bit more play element into it, maybe spread out the commercial areas a bit so that people can have a better feeling of space. And we think, just when you think that you cannot improve upon East Coast Park, I think we can do so. What you see on the left is our famous streetscape. You know that we have about 1.4 million roadside trees, each one of them numbered, we like to say, because we take care, we want to record them in our database and make sure we record our maintenance record and so on. If you think of the current streetscape, they're all more or less monospecies, rain tree. You know, it's that's how we used to do it, Dr. Chua. In those days where we wanted to green up quickly, that was the best way to do it. But as we went along, we discovered that we need more diversity, we need more color, and that's why you look at the photo at the bottom, Central Expressway, it's almost like a forest, layered planting. And that's very deliberate because, first of all, it enhances the robustness of the trees so that one disease that affects one species will not wipe out the whole road. Secondly, we also found that birds and wildlife actually preferred this layered planting, so you can jump from tree to tree. So actually this will help to attract birds, butterflies, and wildlife. And the Tampines Avenue 5 is another type of clustered planting in a sort of more natural planting that we put in place. We had one that's along Kiam Hock Road, and that is really gardening on a nation, city-wide scale. Because we had Sean showed you Bukit Brown, right? Bukit Brown sort of links up MacRitchie and other green areas. We thought, well, how else can we link up MacRitchie and Botanic Gardens, which are two very rich green areas? So we thought, let's plant up the streets and the areas in between. The only problem is we can plant along our streetscape, we have control over that, but at some part of it, it sort of runs into residential estate. So we decided, let's talk to the residents, Kiam Hock, you know, and get them to help us to plant up their gardens and the roadside estate so that there's continuity. And lo and behold, when we met up with them, they were so keen to come together with us to do it. So it's a really nice project. If you go there, you'll see that the Nature Way is doing very well. So we have, Dr. Chua also mentioned Park Connector Network, PCN for short. Right now, we have around 230, 240 kilometers worth of PCN, many loops. But again, it has allowed, having a PCN allowed us to think bigger. So we thought, what's the biggest loop you can do in Singapore? Well, we thought a round island route, a route that goes around the island. So if you look at the map, there's a sort of red line that goes around the island, and then the green part is the east coast. 150 kilometers long. It will pass through many attractions, nature attractions and otherwise, and it will be, I think, a new dimension in recreation in Singapore. Imagine a 150 kilometer cycling route. You can actually do a 2-3 day expedition with farm stays and all that. It's possible, right? Who would have thought that it's such a thing could be possible in Singapore? And I didn't show in this map, of course, the rail corridor that runs from north to south. We hope, URA, if you notice a URA person sitting beside you, please give them a nudge. We hope to have a continuous cycling track, because the north-south, the so-called the rail corridor is continuous, right? There are no roads that cut through it. So imagine a 24, 25 kilometer cycling track that's seamless. Very nice. We can do another nudge to the URA guys. Biodiversity is very important for Singapore. Many people do not know, realize how rich our biodiversity is. For example, in terms of hard coral species, tiny Singapore actually has one third of the world species, of whole world species, tiny Singapore. That is something quite unfathomable. In fact, we have about 40% of the number of species as a Great Barrier Reef, which in itself is already, I don't know, a few hundred times the size of Singapore. So very rich. And in terms of bird species, we have about half of what the UK has, about half of what the whole of France have. So very rich in tiny Singapore, and why not make use of it? So the people before us have done a lot of work in the nature reserve, and that's why there's this rich store of biodiversity. But we thought, actually, we can bring this biodiversity closer to people and also bring people closer to this biodiversity. So we'll be looking at bringing some what we call flagship species out into the places where people work, live and play. The hornbill, the bottom left photograph, is the most famous example. Around more than 100 years ago, they were still around. Then when the British came, like what Sean showed you, they planted plantations, got rid of the forests, and they were driven, the hornbills were driven out of Singapore. They were effectively extinct in Singapore. But a few years ago, some came back, and we decided to help them re-establish in Singapore. So we built artificial nest boxes, because you realize they build nests in tree cavities. There are not many natural tree cavities around, so we have to have artificial ones, boxes with a cavity inside. And we found that they really like the nest boxes. So today, we have about more than 100 hornbills in Singapore, about 60 in Pulau Ubin, and 40 in the mainland. And they are still growing, which we're very happy to see. They're beautiful birds. The other species we're looking at, magpie robin. Dr. Chua mentioned this. That's a black and white bird, the bottom right-hand corner, beautiful bird. Slow loris, top right-hand corner. Otters, we also have otters, which is quite amazing. Liak suggested put otters in Marina Bay, still thinking about it. But the most important part of a garden is that it has to be owned by the community. I guess 1963, it was one man's top-down idea. It worked to a large extent, but going forward, it has to be not just one man's vision, it has to be shared by the rest of Singapore. So we have done, we have tried to do a lot in terms of engaging the community. For example, our Community in Bloom program, currently we have 600 community gardens in Singapore, tended by people in residential estates, in schools, factories even, you know, commercial estate and so on and so forth. 600, which is not a small number. But we are challenging ourselves to increase this number to 1,000. I think when Singapore has 1,000 community gardens, all run sort of bottom-up, energy and passion and so on and so forth. It will be a different Singapore. Kiam Hock Nature Way I spoke about just now. Interestingly, Kiam Hock, you know, is a rich man area, landed estate. You know, when we talked to them, they came out, they do planting together and so on, and they were so happy. Some of them told us that, look, before NParks came, I didn't even know who my neighbor was. Maybe the house is too big. Cannot really see your neighbor. But with this planting, we came to know one another, and a bit of the kampung spirit came back, which I think is great. So sometimes we look at community spirit in HDB estates. Actually, we need that in the rich, so-called rich man area too, right? Because it's also part of Singapore. In terms of community, well, what we try to show, the picture on the left, NParks officer doing work. What we don't want for city in the garden is only the NParks officers doing work. Of course, we'll continue to facilitate, continue to work with the community, but what we want are more the things that we show on the right. For example, in Bishan Ang Mo Kio Park, there's a group of about 20 volunteers, I understand MediaCorp staff, who help us do horticultural work, which is unusual in Singapore. Most of we have about 900 volunteers. NParks, I think we're probably one of the more advanced in terms of agencies, in terms of engaging the community for volunteerism. We have about 900 active volunteers, but most of them do guided walks, you know, educational outreach, the usual thing that Singaporeans like to do. Not many Singaporeans like to do horticultural work, weeding, cleaning up the river, and so on and so forth. But this group we are experimenting with in Bishan Ang Mo Kio Park because they are interested in it and we want to do more. We want to have more of such groups so that Singaporeans will literally roll up their sleeves and tend the garden for us. Okay, and also the bottom picture I like to show, which is basically volunteers doing intertidal research and also helping us to do what we call biodiversity surveys, marine biodiversity surveys. Why I want to bring up this example, gardening, when it comes to gardening, I think most people have the idea that it's done by retirees, old people. I think, not quite true, but there's a bit of truth in that. Huh? Gardening tends to be done by the more mature people. But when we call for volunteers for nature conservation stuff, it's a lot of young people. And that's what I love to see. Right? Even when I give talks like this to schools, to universities, to the polys, actually in during the question and answer session, many of them will ask me, what can I do? You know, what can I actually do to contribute to the effort and so on? And that's lovely to see, right? The generation that people criticize are always just the most that they'll go to is to set up online petitions. You know, that's the extent of their activism. I think it's great that this is an area the young people really want to do something about. Yeah, this is the Bishan Ang Mo Kio example that I was talking about. The other example is the Morning Greeters. It's a very ground-up initiative. This group of young people go around the parks, especially Bishan Park, to greet people in the morning. You know, they just run around in the morning and greet people, bring a smile to people's face. It's a bit intangible, but they're very passionate about it. They even set up a Facebook page. If you can search for it, they update the page quite often. I think this is great, because what we want to see is we have the green areas, we have the parks, we have the assets. It is for people to make use of, to connect with the rest of the community, right? Because all said and done, a park is also a community space. Challenges. I don't have slides for this. I've been quoted in the papers to say that, well, our top three challenges are space, space, and space. If it's, again, a nudge at the URA people. It is true. Our biggest technical reason is actually, technical challenge is actually space or the lack of space. URA will tell you, and it's true, that there are many competing users of space. So even as our population increases, we also need to have a lot more green space in order to give people the sense of spaciousness, a good living environment. And this is very important. Remember, more than 80% of people think that parks and greenery, nature are important even if they don't visit it. Just having the park and green space there gives them comfort, right, a psychological relief. So it's very important. But it's very challenging, we know, and URA has been very supportive. We want to thank them. And we have to think, I think, out of the box, not just ask for more space from URA, we also have to maximize what we have, make the best use of what we have, so that we have good quality green spaces in Singapore. But that's our biggest technical challenge. Because if you dig deeper, actually at the heart of it is actually the hearts of people. Because what do people really want, right? If people want more shopping malls, if 99% of Singaporeans want more spaces for shopping malls, then the URA probably will have no choice but to allocate more space for shopping malls. But if more people want and value green spaces, then I think there can be a conversation about how much or having more space, more land allocated for parks and greenery. So that's why I say the biggest technical challenge is space, land, but actually at the heart of it is what people want. Okay, so with that, I just wanted to maybe say two things. This is our Facebook page. If nothing else, come and like us. Secondly, I feel like a traveling salesman. We just launched this book this past weekend. It talks about our journey for the last 50 years and what we hope to see probably in the next 50 years. It's got nice pictures and so on. So I think you can find this in major bookshops. Yeah, so do buy a copy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, speakers, for the most interesting and thought-provoking presentations. I think all of us can agree that fundamentally, the speakers spoke with a lot of passion, and we can all sense the passion coming from them. Next, we will have a dialogue with the panelists, and this will be moderated by Professor Neo. After which, Prof. Neo will open up the floor to ask for the audience to ask questions. There are microphones at the aisle. And please introduce yourself by giving your name and your organization before asking your questions. So without further ado, I will now hand the time over to Prof. Neo and the panelists. Please, thank you.
Okay, while the panelists are getting their seats, some of you will be wondering what has a business school professor got to do with all this moderating a session among our pioneers and our leaders in greenery. Well, it was quite a really coincidental development. One day, I think it was 2006, I believe, I got up in the morning and saw the headlines in the Straits Times that we are going to spend close to $1 billion to build a garden in the city center, on prime land, on reclaimed land, and that the $1 billion budget did not include the cost of the land. I couldn't believe it. I thought we have gone crazy. Well, what happened to Singapore? This was nuts. So I begin to inquire and find out why are we doing this? And got my civil service college colleagues to be interested, and then spent close to a year talking to a whole range of our pioneers in greenery as well as our staff in NParks, and literally had probably the most fun case study I've ever done. Met a group of extremely passionate people who really believe in what they have done, doing, deep convictions. And for the first time, I really realized how much I've taken it for granted. The greenery that we have enjoyed in our streets, oftentimes not realizing it until we take a trip overseas and come back and realize that this is a different city. So I really enjoyed it and gone on to do two detailed case studies. In fact, we are finishing the third case study on biodiversity. So that's how I got involved, and that's why I'm here. I'm going to pose a round, or maybe a couple of rounds of questions to the panelists, and then after that we'll open the floor. Let me go back to the seat. Let me start with Dr. Chua, since you spoke of earlier, Dr. Chua. At the time when you were the commissioner, from what I have understood talking to you and other colleagues of yours, the Parks and Recreation departments were really very under-resourced. How did you manage to accomplish so much with so little?
Well, I think in the beginning, I think when we first started the Parks and Recreation Department, we have very little money for the development of parks. Because the first impact that the Prime Minister wanted was to green up all the roads and also for the urbanisation and also the housing. He wanted when these trees were removed, you have to replant them. So I think most of the planting went by HDB because the Parks Department, we don't have to do the planting in stat boards, only in government institutions. But later on, I think as the department expanded to development of parks and all that, I think the Prime Minister wanted the Ministry of Finance to provide more money, because the thing is, he realized at that time, if you plant the trees and shrubs and you don't maintain them, they will die. So you need money also to maintain these trees and shrubs that are planted. And also we have the, once we develop the park, then you have a lot of grass areas and they have to be cut. So these contractors will have to be paid to do this. But I think in the end, the Ministry of Finance did give us the money.
Okay. Well, Hong Yuen used to come from the Ministry of Finance, an engineer by training. When you heard him speak, you probably can't tell, right? And in fact, I think that would be an appropriate question for you to address, perhaps. Given your technical training, your finance, economic background, how would you describe or characterize for us the economic value of greenery for Singapore?
By the way, for the MND and the MOF people in the audience, NParks today is still under-resourced. okay, next question, right? Okay, how to have it put the economic value on greenery, I think it's very difficult. I know some people out there are actually working hard to do that. Even internationally, people are trying to put the value on what they call, I think what Sean mentioned, the ecosystem services. Wendy is nodding her head. Even within NParks, some people, like Wendy, are very passionate about, you know, coming up with some economic justification for greenery. And I think the work ought to carry on. I think it's very important work. If we can make strides in this direction, that would be really great. But I always caution people like Wendy. When I was sitting in MOF, I'll often get papers and proposals with similar concept, right? Put an economic value on pollution, on clean air, clean water, and so on and so forth. Very well-meaning, and I think if it helps us to understand the context of the issues or the problems, I think they are useful, but we cannot rely too much on them. Why? Because for a person who is evaluating the proposal, if the number is very small, meaning the value is very small, we say, see, I told you so, it's not an important area, so I don't have to allocate much resources to it. If the number is very big, I will probably say, look, it's because of your assumptions. It's too big to be believed. It is not realistic. After all, you know these numbers. If you just change some numbers, you know, the assumption by a bit, you can come up with very different figures. So we ought to be quite careful. But again, just to make myself very clear, it's not that I don't think there's any value to it. I think if it helps us to understand the problem, the magnitude of the problem, I think it's helpful. But just that we cannot rely on it to make very mechanical decisions. Because like I said, if Lee Kuan Yew had waited for economic justification, economic value to justify his decision, we wouldn't have gone for Garden City, right? It's his gut. Actually, this morning, my chairman was telling me, hey, did you know that, my chairman is Christina Ong, did you know that Lee Kuan Yew justified greenery by saying that it was supposed to retain rainfall and so on and so forth? I say, I know. In fact, if you read his books, he had many, many reasons to justify greenery. So my conclusion, I'm not speaking on his behalf, I don't know, I'm just speculating. I think he liked greenery. His gut, his heart told him that greenery is good. And then he found reasons to tell people, this is what he did it. This is why he did it, you know? So he said, oh, I did this to, you heard this before, I did this to attract investors, right? I said, yeah, right. So I did this so that we can have, he said he went to the UK, and he found that in London, for example, only the rich areas had nice greenery. The poor areas did not have nice greenery at that time, maybe. And he said, no, Singapore cannot be like that. So for me, you know, Singapore all over must have greenery. So that's another justification. We want people to have the nicer, you know, ambient temperature. That's another. So many reasons. I think in the end, it's a gut. So if your gut tells you that, look, this is something we need to have, then I think more or less you want to do it. And if you can find reasons to justify it, so much better.
Thank you. Sean, you mentioned earlier in your presentation that there were times that you do have differences with the agencies in trying to promote nature. When do you decide to persevere and when do you decide to kind of go along with the decision? How do you decide?
I was hoping to ask you for advice on that one. You often hear, and I don't know if, not having grown up here, but living here, having lived here for 25 years, I always hear the term, there's a Singapore context, there's a Singapore way of doing things. You don't do things in a, for example, in terms of activism, you don't take a confrontational, contrarian approach, but you try to, you go in at the right, appropriate moment in an appropriate way to make one's point. And I see the value in that. And I think I'll give you a quick example. I think there were two incidents that I made a brief mention of. One, both in the early 90s. One was the Marina South. There were in that reclaimed land. There had been some ponds that had accumulated, and quite a number of rare birds had come to that area. Now, here's where then the Nature Society had called for, in some ways, preserving the bird life of Marina South. Now, here's where the story diverges, and Dr. Chua would know one. It's like Rashomon. You know, everybody has a little different version. One is that the Nature Society was actually unreasonable, that there was reclaimed land with great value. It wasn't even a nature area. It was the sea, and the birds just happened to come. And now to make the ridiculous point of you know, calling to preserve reclaimed land, which, you know, it's just kind of a non sequitur. The other interpretation I hear is that and it could have been partly a miscommunication. The other interpretation I hear was that it wasn't so much that people were asking that this reclaimed land be set aside as a nature reserve or anything, but rather, if there's to be parkland in the Marina South area anyway, would there be any chance of either incorporating those ponds into that park or somehow building a series of ponds and the birds might oblige and kind of move over until where the final, wherever the park is to be sited, they would have not only greenery, but bird life. There's probably an element of truth to both of those, I have to admit. And so on the one hand, I do agree, yes, there is probably a more conciliatory and positive approach to these things. But at the same time, I think there is a kind of a fundamental belief. Mr. Poon referred to what does your gut tell you and your heart tell you. And for many people, I think, and again, they're not, but the thing is, they're not incompatible. This is another thing. Early on, I used to hear, even 2-3 years ago, I spoke in this auditorium and somebody asked me, so Nature Society, are you for government or are you against government? I mean, it's not either, it's for nature is what we are. And so then the question is, for many people, whether you're a developer or a civil servant, just a regular, you know, a scientist or just a regular citizen, I think to see wildlife, to see nature, to see wild nature is something that's valuable. It's meaningful. It's enriching, and it's not just about, you know, saving birds, but it's about making life that much more wonderful and magical. And so then comes the challenge. How do you convince people that, yes, nature is compatible with a highly developed, fast-paced, modern landscape, and that there is a way, both scientifically, in terms of engineering, in terms of public outreach, in terms of policy, to line these up so that as many of these, the best possible compromise can be reached. And then to set, and then because of the clout that we have as an economic engine, as people who work overseas and have a big impact, not just here, but all over the world, this can produce a knock-on effect that's really going to benefit people the world over. And to me, that is one of the challenges.
Thank you, very tactfully said. Right? Shannon, maybe let me come back to you again. The plans for greening were formalized mostly in the 1990s. There weren't really a formalized greenery plan in the earlier years, and particularly the time when you were the commissioner. How do you make progress without a plan?
I think this one, we work very closely with URA, and URA designate certain areas to be developed as parks, and also when they have development for housing, they have, I think they have this open space. You have the smaller gardens, which is called the open spaces developed. So actually, not say that we don't have a plan, because first, I think the URA designated certain areas that we can use as parks, because these would be as green lungs for Singapore, especially next to housing estates and all that. That's how Ang Mo Kio Toa Payoh parks were developed by us, and also Pasir Ris, because at that time, I think they were housing was starting that in that those areas. So actually, in a way, the plan was determined by URA. And we, the Parks Department was an agent to develop these parks, and we get the money from Ministry of Finance, which we have to put up our budget every year. Because before that, we know already what are the various areas going to be developed as parks. Yeah. So it's not true that we don't have a plan, because we work very closely with URA those days, because the chief planner will do all these things for us. And also we work very closely with the roads branch of PWD. And because new areas developed, the roads are being built, and we do the roadside planting for them. So in a way, they're already planned, done by URA for the whole urbanization of Singapore. So as I said, it's not true that we don't have a plan.
But it was an overall land use plan, not a particular green plan as such. Yes. The green plan actually came out only in the 1990s. So you're right in the sense that there is some planning, but not a specific plan for greenery as such.
Yes.
Yeah. Coming to Hong Yuen again, one of the, as I mentioned earlier, things that really was significant for me when I take a look at
how we have developed over the years, was really the people of NParks and its predecessor organizations. Very unusual agency, very unusual culture, very unusual people with deep conviction, commitment. And when you came on board a few years ago, and it was probably a very unusual civil service or a government organization, how would you characterize the importance of the type of institution and the development that we were able to make in terms of greenery? The culture of the institution, the people, the commitment of the people.
Well, organizationally, this multi-syllable word. Actually, we're a very unusual organization. If you look internationally, another multi-syllable word, there are not many organizations like NParks. Even in the more developed countries, you have one organization taking care of the nature reserves, another organization taking care of parks, maybe the city council that looks after the roadside trees. They don't have it all together. We are very rare in that we have it all together, which is very important for a city like Singapore, because we are able to do integrated things. So the nature way that I was talking about is basically linking a nature reserve with streetscape, residential planting to a botanic garden, you know, which in a different country would be done by four different agencies. How do you get it together? But we can. We can do it quite easily, actually. So I think in terms of organization structure, we are unique. But you mentioned culture. Actually, as you asked the question to Dr. Chua about not having a plan, actually, I think that's sorry if I contradict you a little bit. I think it is quite true, or at least half true, even today. Because we take pains to tell people that our city and the garden framework is not a plan, it's a framework. Meaning, it's we tell you there are six strategic trusts, and every year we can review, and things that we want to do inside that framework could change. In fact, we have launched it for about two years, and we have a few major pieces inside that were not in there in the beginning, and that's perfectly fine. Because I believe in NParks, there's a very strong culture of getting things done. I think from the very beginning, it was like that. Mr. Lee said, plant this tree, pop, 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 it's done. and it's a very valuable culture, because sometimes there are people who say that, hey, why don't you do a study on the effect of the ecology before you do something? It's possible, and I suppose scientifically it's the right thing to do, but the approach that we prefer is get it done and then study. Rather than study, then get it done. Because the study may take years, and that's not our style. Our style, very, very strong culture of just getting it done, and then we monitor. If it works, we roll it out even more. If it doesn't work, then we just keep quiet and roll it back. You know? And I think that describes, in a sense, the Singapore public service culture a bit. But I think I've been through a few government agencies and ministries. I think that sort of culture is very strong in NParks. And I think it's possible because of the strong passion that you can see in our people. I think I'll gush a little bit. Our people are really fantastic. I suppose that type of culture of getting it done may not work if people are don't feel so strongly about what they do. But our people feel very strongly about what they do. There was once one business executive told me, you know, Poon, I would like to be NParks chairman. I said, why? You see, the people that you have, I think if I slash everybody's pay, everybody's salary by half, there'll still be 20% of NParks officers who still stick around. And I say, think about it, actually, that is quite true. And those are the type of people you need to get things done very quickly, rather autonomously, and still, you know, nothing major goes wrong. That's very important.
Maybe let me ask you to comment a little bit more. NParks work with NGOs like Nature Society and others way earlier than other agencies. Work with individuals, work with communities much earlier than other agencies have. How do you explain that?
Well, that's the, I claim no credit for it because it started way earlier than me, my predecessors. I think that's a realization. Well, you see, we are unique in another aspect. In all countries, education is very important, right? For example, if you say that I'm doing education, nobody will argue with you. It's all very important. If I tell people I'm in the armed forces, security is very, nobody will argue with you. But only in Singapore, actually, is greenery that important. Only in Singapore is greenery pursued with such, I would say, almost a missionary zeal, you know. And so it's something that we don't want to take for granted, you know, because what we do, we know, and parks we know are important, but we want to make sure that everybody else knows that it's important. And that's why we always felt that we must go out to the community to seek buy-in. If I were doing education, I wouldn't need to go out and tell you that, look, education is very important, you know. But since we're doing something that we feel very strongly about and we need buy-in, we needed to go to the community. I suppose the second reason, again, comes down to the passion of our people. It's a bit evangelical, if I may say so. They feel so proud of what they do. They love what they do so much that they have to share it with people, and that comes very naturally for our guys, and so that's what we did. And same thing with Nature Society. Sometimes I suspect I'm running an NGO myself, you know. In fact, some of our guys come from NGOs. So actually, we do have quite a bit of like-mindedness with the NGOs and the nature groups, but at the same time, of course, recognizing that we are a government agency and we have the responsibilities of a government agency. We play that bridging role, but we understand where they come from, so we're very comfortable talking to them. Not always been so, but I think once we started to talk, I think especially from Dr. Tan's time, then we felt that, look, we could understand each other very well.
Sean, you hinted earlier that that Nature Society may have a different vision for the city in the garden. There's probably more natural, less landscape, but you did not really elaborate on that. If you have your way, what would you do differently?
I guess you're not a dean of the business school for nothing, Prof. Neo. I mean, these are tough questions, my goodness. I
do think there is synergy between, and it's not a question of do we have a manicured landscape or do we have a wild landscape, but I think I do agree with Mr. Poon in that, you know, Singapore is a nation of doers, so we do, but it's not, you know, I don't think it's also not just do and then study. There is this, like, you know, there is this wealth of knowledge out there, some of it generated here, some of it overseas, and there are scientific principles, that ecological principles that one can use to one's advantage in designing that landscape. There will be the manicured areas, there will be the core nature areas, and the question is, how do you treat that landscape so that you are maximizing the different, you know, the sense of place, the cooling effect of greenery, the aesthetic, the cultural, as well as the biodiversity. And I do think that, you know, if I had my way, I guess we would have more rainforest in places. Not that we would come at the expense of human habitation, you know, or anything like that. But you know, I think maybe in some ways we don't in the nature community and perhaps our colleagues at national parks and the university, maybe we don't get across some of these feelings the convictions clearly enough. So I'll give you an example. I mean, now there are plans for the construction of Bidadari into an estate, and there is to be quite a sizable park. It just so happens that that much of the woodland there might be used for housing. I mean, no issue in the sense that the nation's development needs take precedence. But at the same time, this woodland, as well as woodlands in near the Jurong Lake District and other places, have birds that are only temporary residents. They come during the migratory season and they move off. They're either going north for their breeding or south to overwinter. But it turns out that these are birds, both forest birds that go to places like Bidadari, or shore birds that go to places like Mandai. It's not a case of you clear this, they'll go to some other place. I think the thing is, these are animals, and they've been doing this migration for God knows how many tens of thousands of years. I mean, it's really a miracle of nature that they come so far, and every place along this flyway has a role to play. Even tiny little Singapore, Malaysia, Taiwan, the Philippines, these are all, you know, stopover points. And so maybe it's not a debate about what do we do with Bidadari, but the idea is how can Singapore provide this home, wherever it may be, that's appropriate so that we can continue to play this integral part. We don't want to be the weak link, break the chain, and this you know, millennia old migration is stopped on account of we didn't really kind of apply what we know about the natural history of these organisms, and you know, I don't want to be the people that kind of blew it, and I don't think we have to be. And it's just kind of, what do these birds do? What's their value, both locally and internationally? What can we do in a kind of integrated landscape to fulfill their needs as well as meet ours? And so I think you just start with first principles and see to what extent they can be implemented.
Thank you. And thank you very much for all your frank answers, Sean, as well. Let me now open the floor to you. We have a very distinguished panel. Put up your hand, and then when I call on you, just say who you are, where you're from, and then your question or comment, but make it short. Anybody want to start? No one? Then we can leave early. Yeah. Can always count on you.
I just shout out there. Just to start the ball rolling. Dr. Choi has such a great idea to plant the fruit trees. I would have loved to get three fruits ripened on the plant. How come the whole thing just came about?
Well, I think we planted started from the camps, and then the housing estate, HDB in particular. And actually, when we, after planting, we cannot, we would not be able to maintain it because it's a lot of manpower involved. So we pass it on to the resident committees. So I do not know why they couldn't coordinate among themselves to get the fruits and distribute. And maybe they found it a bit too much of a chore. So eventually, I think the RCs gave up the idea. So, but the trees were still there, you know, except the ones that are a lot of fruits that dropped, and then they get rotten and the flies come in. So these trees were removed. So actually the Parks Department did the planting only for them. And the whole idea was then the Prime Minister wanted to inculcate social discipline, and you want to have the children to respect public property. And that was the reason why he wanted the fruit trees to be planted. So we did that. And then, of course, we pass it on to the resident committees to manage it. So after that, I do not know what happened with the RCs.
Actually, it's not totally gone. Sengkang Riverside Park actually is a fruit-themed park, and many fruit trees planted there. Only thing is the fruits usually don't have the chance to ripen. So they get harvested way before. Unfortunately, yeah, people are a bit impatient, or maybe they thought if I don't harvest it today, somebody will harvest it. So I think there's a bit of education as well. We try to tell people, don't, you know, wait a while, be a bit more patient. But it's still going on, but it's more manageable in the park, right? In the streetscape where the span of area is so wide, it's a bit difficult to manage. Also, if it's a roadside tree, sometimes you read in the papers there's some disputes, who should be getting the fruit and so on and so forth. But it's not dead. It's not done in a major way, I suppose. But it's still around in some form.
Actually, the contrast is quite interesting when we try to do it from the government side, the tree plant or the fruit planting, it didn't quite work out as well. But Hong Yuen just mentioned that we have 600 communities in blue. Gardening club, from the ground, now the RCs are the one who wants it. It's not initiated by NParks, it's initiated by the residents. And many of them grow fruit trees as well, right? I think that's a good lesson for us. Doesn't always work because government initiated. In this case, I heard you the last time, you have about four or five people, right, staff, supporting 600 community clubs who are really focusing on gardening and fruit trees, communities in bloom. I think what a fantastic achievement that is. Primarily because the role of the agency has changed in supporting, being there as a resource and helping it make it work. Am I correct to say that? Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the staff strength of our community in Bloom team hasn't grown for the don't know how many years. Although now we have 600 community gardening groups, and that's possible because, like Prof say, we are able to be a facilitator. We train them, and then they go off and do their thing. When they need advice, they come back to us again. And from there, we observe the groups. If they're good people, good gardeners, good leaders, we also appoint them ambassadors. We call CIB, Community in Bloom Ambassadors. Some are very old. There's a very old auntie, and there's a very young boy in his teens, quite a number of ambassadors. And they go out and seed gardening groups, and they do the work for us. So it's really quite fantastic. And then once in a while, we organize sessions for them to come together to share gardening tips, to encourage one another to keep going, you know, because sometimes it's not easy. And that's how it's grown to 600. Actually, I told my guys, I want to grow it to 1,000 with the same staff strength. Oh, cannot be done. Okay, so finally, I increased a bit of staff strength, but it's largely the same team, same number of people who have done it from 0 to 600.
Anybody else? Yes, somebody. Yeah, there's a mic at the side. Yeah.
Good afternoon. My name is Alan Hui from Greenback. We make compost out of trees, and I just want to have an observation with regard to the city, the financial center that we have. I find that it's a bit too concrete. I walk from one point to another point, I can't find any trees, don't have any shade, and all nothing but buildings. But we have done very well in parks, HDB, housing estate. And this is what we are lacking. The reason why I say this is because I saw the word city in the garden. That's all.
Okay, I don't know which stretch you're talking about. I think in general, it is true we are facing pressures in terms of space for planting. We always, again, do the URA nudge again. We always try to get more space for planting. If you look at, for example, don't talk about city center, even the Kampong Java stretch, ironically, outside, or maybe quite appropriately, outside the LTA headquarters, because of road widening and so on and so forth, from a very lush landscape, we've come to almost quite a bare and concrete landscape. So that's out of necessity. I must say that LTA in general works with us very closely to try to retain greenery as much as possible. But sometimes it's just very difficult. You know, if you need to widen the roads, then you just need space. And we try our very best, even when you talk about very narrow strips, we try to plant something, but it's not always possible, right? So I do think moving forward, we need to think a lot more out of the box. So we're prepared to do things that we have never considered doing. Okay. So just to give you an example, we are now contemplating taking over some of the maintenance of greenery from some other parties. So example, MRT operator. We've always told them that, look, your MRT station, you need to plant trees and you need to maintain them. But you know what? That's not their core business. And frankly, they don't care very much about greenery. I mean, truth be told. And they don't do it very well. They don't have scale as well. But sometimes we look at it, look, this MRT station could be just next to a park. Why can't I just take over the maintenance? Maybe you still pay me, and then I'll look at it. But I mean, it's just something that we have always said no. But I told our guys, we really need to think out of the box, because if we really want a city and a garden, we must do things differently. And what we don't have is space. We're running out of it, but certainly we can work together with all stakeholders to ensure there's some quality of what we have left, make the best of what we have, and then still achieve our city in the garden vision.
Raymond? Yeah. Raymond, and then somebody there and the other side. Planning parameter and then the vertical greenery?
There is working with URA, again, there are planning parameters for green spaces. Out of 1,000 population, we're supposed to have a certain number of hectares of park space. That's just for parks. And then in the recent white paper, we also talk about having 85% of the population within 400 meters of a park, which is not bad. Considering that actually if you take out landed estate, we are, I think, probably already more than 85%, right? If you go down to HDB estate, everybody has a green space, right? So actually for us to achieve a high percentage of people within easy reach of parks is very possible. So we do have. Always able to reach it? Well, it is a very dynamic thing, as you would understand, right? It's not as if the population stays where it is and we just run after the fixed goalpost. Sometimes the goalpost gets further and further and we just have to sort of chase after it a bit. But we have the parameters and we try to achieve them, right? So that's what planning. The second question was on the skyrise greenery. Actually, I have been around a few places in the world to look at skyrise greenery, even in some cities where they claim that they are, like, for example, some cities in Germany claim that they are the rooftop greenery capital of Europe or whatever. But frankly, I look at it, our skyrise greenery compares very well. I realize I'm not being that modest here, but really compares very well. A couple of years back, we had the Skyrise Greenery Conference, international conference, that we organized with some international green roof association or something. And international delegates came, and as usual, we had learning journeys. And my staff told me, jaws collectively dropped because of the quality of our green roofs. Not only those few that you talk about, if you want to note down, there's this green sort of indoor garden in 158 Cecil Street, which is, if you Google it, you look it up, it is absolutely lovely. It's out of this world. And it's done as commercial thing, right? If you look at, I think you're talking about, is that 6 Battery Road, where they have a Patrick Blanc wall that costs $1 million? And it's actually very interesting. These are very nice green walls and so on. They are done, on, as I said, with commercial consideration. Not because we gave them money, but they were renovating very old office buildings, and you realize that to compete in the market, they have to be some. They have to have something very distinctive, and so they came up with, well, quintessentially Singaporean, right? A very beautiful green space inside the building, outside the building, for the tenants to enjoy, and so people are willing to pay higher rents. To me, that is great. That is the best virtuous cycle that we can create. You know, the business professor nods his head. Because if we have government subsidies and government exhortations, it can only go so far. But when a businessman see that it makes dollars and cents to have green walls and so on, then I think we've reached the stage where it can be self-perpetuating. But I must say, why I say our green roofs and green walls are very good, because the quality is excellent. Even the HDB, well, I shouldn't say even the HDB, but scrub up the even. The HDB green roofs, actually very good. Very, very good. The ones that we saw in Punggol, actually you can't even tell that they're green roofs. You thought that it's true what we call true ground planting, but they're actually on top of car parks, right? Right now they have a lot of green roofs on top of car parks, and they're excellent quality. But sometimes I think Singapore pride, when we do things, we want to do things very nicely. And actually, I'm encouraging also our guys to also look at what the Europeans call an extensive type of green roof, meaning they just leave the space bare and weeds just grow. And it's all right because it's naturalized green roof. So I think we can have both. We can have the very, what they call intensive green roofs and green walls that people look at and marvel and feel inspired to do more. But there can also be the extensive type of green roof that you can just slap there, and it helps to achieve the benefit of cooling down temperatures and so on and so forth, and greening the environment, and you don't have to spend so much money and effort to build and maintain. So we can have both. So if you ask me, we've only done one half. There's a lot more we can do in skyrise greenery. So I'm confident we can actually even aim to be a skyrise capital of the world. It's possible for us to do so.
Okay, there's a question on this side of it. Yeah, please.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen and panelists. My name is Shelley Siu, and please excuse me for bragging, but to be credible, I'm here actually to speak as a private resident of an estate in Singapore and the winner of the best garden competition a few years ago. So my problem is labor shortage. Whilst you have challenges in cleaning estates and parks, I observe that many of our cleaners are outsourced. And because they are outsourced from third world countries, how do we know that they are here to clean according to the expectations and levels of our global city? I know because I watch the cleaners. They come, they use a blower, they pollute with noise, they pollute the air, they blow the leaves, a few minutes they walk off, and they don't gather the leaves, they don't put them in bags, and of course, over a few days, the leaves are scattered again. And over the days, you have more and more leaves being scattered. And I want to know whether they are properly trained here, how to clean, and whether there is supervision to make sure that the cleanliness is enforced, the cleaning is enforced. I'd like to know that, please. Thank you.
I think we hear you, but it's not a cleaning panel. It's a greening panel. So you don't mind, I think we can probably, the right agency will probably be the NEA. Am I correct? Because it's a street cleaning, yeah, rather than NPARK. So I think it's not a fair question for the panel.
Park cleaning.
Park cleaning, okay.
Yes, it's parks.
If somebody has questions for Shawn or Dr. Chua, please put up your hands now. It's a good point. It's a challenge, obviously. And frankly, right now, we're looking very seriously at insourcing. Because you're right, we probably outsource a lot. And we want to see whether we can do some of these things ourselves so as to sort of at least have a certain benchmark of standards. But that's aside. But in terms of training, I would say, in fact, well, we may not do it perfectly, but John Tan is there. He's the president of the Industry Association for Landscaping. But I would say, compared to many industries, we are recognized as having done more in training. And that's why 2-3 years back, we received an award from INSEAD and MOM for our training system. Because we don't just train our own people. We have a center to train our own people, but we... Did I say too much? But we extend the training to industry as well. And we've seen that the industry have started to realize that training is very important. And not only, we may not do that much training in cleaning, but we do training in horticulture, right? So we realize that even the foreign workforce is also an important component of our industry, and we need to train them. But like I say, we're still learning. We don't do it perfectly. But we're trying. This is not something that we don't do at all.
There was a question from, yeah, please.
Hello, my name is Rhea. I'm from Wild Singapore. I think some of the panel knows me. I'm crazy about marine life in Singapore. We have amazing marine biodiversity, so I was wondering if I could hear some thoughts about how to extend this idea of city in a garden to beyond the, you know, the high water mark, well, towards the reefs and seagrass meadows and mangroves. Thank you.
I'll get Shawn to start.
Actually, Rhea, we should look to you, you know, for some of the answers on that one. But I must say there was something quite interesting with regard to this. I had not me, but my colleague had a student who did a study of an odd community. It's just outside the new water plant. It's next to the Sungai Bedok and the Sungai Ketapang, I think, of these canals. And when that water backs up at high tide, it flows into the canal system. And it just so happened that a couple of these longkangs had the tiles broken. So in the middle of Tanah Merah, there was this community of, they're mud skippers. I mean, of course, it's within the tidal flow, but to go to Bedok and then you look down and there's mud skippers and mud crabs and fiddler crabs and all these things that you would think you have to go to the beach to see, and they're there. And it just seems so out of place. And then I just thought, well, these animals do come. It's just a matter of how can we kind of integrate it in some way into our living environment. So a lot of the times what we do, I guess, with nature groups is we take people out to nature. The other thing would be, how can we bring it in the way that's possible? And if you really think about it, of course, in many parts of Singapore, the tide no longer reaches because we've managed to turn these into reservoirs. But there are still places in vast swathes of the island where it is still possible to see the tide. And it's a question of how do you maybe give access, make it safe, but still, and then have the interpretation and the support, and also kind of get people to overcome sometimes their intrinsic uneasiness, I guess, over coexisting with nature. And I think if I could use that to maybe comment earlier on Mr. Poon's comment on skyrise gardenings. I mean, so again, that's the idea. How do you have a basic infrastructure which provides a service, a longkang that transports water, a skyrise garden that is cooling and aesthetic, pleasing without actually subtracting from the functionality of it, but then adding the biodiversity component. You've not done anything that makes a building or a structure impractical, but then you've got the educational and the biodiversity part comes into it as well. And you know, with skyrise gardens, I mean, if I had my way, no, if not so much if I had my way, but I think this could be a real reservoir of insect life
if you can get people to accept insect life like bees, which are quite harmless actually, they can be they can not only live on the rooftop garden, but when they decide to go and forage, they go out into our wild areas and do the pollination. You know, so they could be performing a very important ecoservice function. The other thing is we have buildings, we need them. The Stanchart building was mentioned, these other. It turns out that a lot of these things are like the Death Star for migratory birds. In some, I'm not saying they are in Singapore, but what I am saying is what we haven't done is we haven't actually looked at the subtractive effects of much of our infrastructure, our nature. And I guess the idea would be, let's understand, do we have this issue? I mean, a guy I spoke to in Toronto, his record in Toronto, 2 buildings, 6 hours, 500 dead birds. They just kept slamming into this building because they did not know. They thought they were just flying through trees or sky, and they hit a glass on building. And again, so, you know, do we have, is this an issue in Singapore? If it is, there are very easy ways to remedy it without actually compromising the integrity or the aesthetics of a building. And so I guess it's about knowledge, looking for the win-win, if that's, sorry, it's a cliche, and then getting people to appreciate it. So there's going to be always a few people like Rhea, myself, and a few others who love it. But then it's a question of how can we make that another simple pleasure in life for, you know, the 5.4 million other people who live in Singapore. And God, what a happy society we'd be, you know, if we were out there looking at and celebrating nature together.
Rhea, sometimes I have some of my own staff asking the same question. Oh, we talk about green. How about blue? You know, how about marine and so on? I tell them it's the same thing. Green is a shorthand for nature. Actually, some of my staff, I suspect, are planted by Rhea as agents to ask those questions. But it's to us, we already do quite a lot for marine. We can do a lot more, I guess. Many of you would not know, actually, we have what they call coral nurseries. You know nurseries, right? You put young plants. We actually plant corals in the sea, and then we sort of translocate them to different areas in Singapore to plant them and so on. So we do planting of corals as well. We also do surveys of our marine life. And another reason why I say that the two are one is actually in many areas, the two are integrated, right? When you talk about mangrove planting, a sungai buloh, actually you're also talking about marine biodiversity. When you look at the river in Bishan, Ang Mo Kio Park, you're talking about blue, or rather water biodiversity in the middle of a park. So, and of course we have swamps, we have wetlands and so on and so forth. So it's to me, there's nothing to say that we are not, we leave this out or leave that out, because it's self-defeating. They're all the same. In any case, the kid that holds the sea cucumber in his hand when he goes to visit Chek Jawa feels excited about nature in general. He doesn't think, oh, this is marine biodiversity, I'm not interested in plants. It's all the same. You know, when we get people excited, whether it's the sea cucumber in his hand or a hornbill that flies past, it's all about nature. And that same kid, depending on his inclination, which side of nature, will want to do more for nature in general.
We probably could have one or two more at most. Anybody else? Okay.
Hi, my name is Karthik Karkal. I'm actually an urban designer with CPG Consultants. So as I hear, sit here and listen to all the experts, I see that there is focus from NParks talking about something like a city in a garden, in the sense about trees and about managing and maintenance and everything. And I see from Nature Reserve, I mean Nature Reserve, but from Sean, talking about biodiversity and rainforest and everything. And so I see a big difference. right? Do we see as we move forward, right, even say in Singapore with the white paper and everything, do you see these things really come together or actually move apart? Because for you, NParks, it's more about really maintenance and managing all these resources with the competing land users, and you have, you are the authority, right? And you can make decisions. But you're talking about something greater, right? Trying to connect people to nature and all of those larger issues, right? So moving forward, do you see these things really coming together or actually diverging further away from each other?
Thank you. How do I say this? I think actually both things are happening now. Starting already from parks and recreation time, I think there was an effort not just to green Singapore, but to actually add the biodiversity into it. And I think if you looked at Mr. Poon's presentation, showed that streetscapes are now done in such a way as to an extent they mimic an ecosystem with the layering, you know, what you would find in a natural situation. So actually in terms of managing the landscape, it is a little bit more ecological, say, than it might have been, or as we learn to add this component. So that is actually happening, and I'm hoping that it would continue to happen as well. The flip side of it, though, is that, you know, it's almost futile if there's a few people in a stat board and a few nature lovers and marine experts and so on get excited about these things, but there are 5 million or 6 million other people out there for whom, you know, this landscape is just taken for granted. And I think that, to me, would be the challenge, which is how do we successfully engage the community in a meaningful way, in a non, you know, dogmatic sort of way, and to realize that it's beautiful, it's got benefits. Open your eyes, you see wonderful things that really make life that much more meaningful, and it's there, and it's a question of, and I think maybe we as an NGO haven't done a good enough job in making that connection. So I think it's a question of if there's the divergence, I don't think it's a stat board NGO type thing, but it's how do we get this pool of people who are, you know, resource persons, and to take some of that zeal or passion or, you know, joie de vivre, you know, and be able to pass that on to other people. Again, not in a way that's a like nature because it's good for you, but because, you know, people, when they see it for themselves, when we're kids, what's the first thing that we get all excited about? It's birds, it's insects, it's flowers, and somewhere along the line we lose it, and it's about reconnecting with that. So I think it's an awareness issue, largely, and it's about bringing everybody, putting us together in a common mindset.
I see the two as not that different, frankly. What you call nature and managed greenery, actually we manage the nature reserves as well, in the sense that we always have to monitor the state of the nature reserve, and where necessary do enhancement of habitats and so on. We don't just leave everything alone, especially in the context of Singapore, where we are talking about urban biodiversity, we're talking about urban ecosystem. If left as it is, without NParks, there would be very little greenery in the urban setting. You know, and all you have, even if you leave the nature reserves alone, would be the nature reserves. But that would not work in the context of Singapore. In the context of Singapore, the two needs to be seen as one. And therefore, you look at what we're doing in terms of nature ways, we are actually connecting the fragmented pieces of nature areas using our urban network of greenery. If we did not have the urban network of greenery, the nature areas will continue to be fragmented. So it doesn't pay to look at them as separate entities. They are actually one and the same. They contribute to the same thing. And our thinking in terms of park management and park development has also evolved over the years. You know, the last 2 years when we went out to ask people, survey people, what they like to see in parks. Surprisingly or unsurprisingly, one of the top three things that come back was they like to see more nature in parks, which is wonderful, right? Which is wonderful. I don't know whether they mean nature by clump of trees or, you know, real jungle. But I think what people are saying, we don't want too much manicuring, which is fine by us. You know, so as we develop or redevelop the larger parks, we will try to leave more larger areas naturalized so that people still have the nature setting. You still have the playgrounds, play areas, but more nature setting. And that's what we will do more. So it's not one or the other. We'll do more managed greenery in nature and also more nature in managed greenery.
Okay, maybe a last question. Well, I was going to close. Deva, go ahead. Could you use the mic so we can all hear you?
Hello, I'm Chang Yen, a principal planner of Jurong Consultants. I think Singapore is very blessed with abundant rainfall, and that really helps Singapore achieve this garden city much more easier than the temperate climate. I have two questions. In the early days, we had much rain trees, and they've been planted along very major arterials and highways, and it really gives a very warm, romantic feeling as you drive through. But now I think it seems like in land scarce Singapore, I don't see many of these rain trees being planted anymore. So I would really appreciate if NParks can rethink about replanting rain trees in many of these major roads, because it really gives a very lovely feeling when you come home from Changi Airport, you see. The next is that, is there any a scheme to maybe designate roads with a slow moving traffic so you can let these rain trees with less pruning, so that the branches may even reach to the other side of the road, like in Taiping Botanical Gardens, you know. It's such a beautiful scenic drive when you are in Taiping Botanical Gardens. Thank you.
Okay, rain trees. Well, it's not that we stop planting rain trees. You're right. We probably can only plant trees like rain trees, which have large crowns where we have space. Otherwise, it'd be too constricted and stability would be an issue, right? Trees with large crowns also have large root bases. Correct, Dr. Chua, correct? Just checking. So where we can, we may plant rain trees, but in a way, we are trying to do with more diversity and the planting of more native trees. Many people do not realize that actually a rain tree is not native to Singapore. It was brought from Latin America, South America. So it's actually a migrant, you know, which has done very well in Singapore. I compare it to the Chinese, you know. We are migrants and now we're all over the place. But now we try to plant more native trees, more diversity, so that we have multi-layered planting, so that we have richer bird life, butterflies, good insects, and wildlife. Whether we designate roads for less pruning, you mentioned East Coast Parkway. It is a very, very lovely road. Sorry? So-called Mandai, the Mandai, so Upper Thomson, those are really, really lovely stretches that we'll try to keep for as long as possible. We are under pressure all the time. Fortunately, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew is very, very, very fond of East Coast Parkway, and he say preserve it at all costs. So one day you might find us chaining ourselves to the trees to prevent road widening. But though I agree with you, some of these roads are really, really, in a sense, give Singapore a very unique identity. We are very proud of East Coast Parkway. When Norman Foster was in Singapore giving a lecture, somebody asked him, what do you think is the most iconic structure in Singapore? And he mentioned the road leading out of the airport, which is, of course, East Coast Parkway. If you go to all other airports, you go out, warehouse lah, dilapidated lah, you know, it's barren, ugly, and you just want to just close your eyes and open it half an hour later, you get into the city. But in Singapore, it's different. You know, I still remember when we had the Youth Olympic Games, I think one football team from one African team was playing against the Singapore team. So youngsters, right? Apparently they sort of the press detailed their arrival from the airport to the hotel, and apparently they were so dumbstruck by the beauty of East Coast Parkway. These are African kids, you know. So from Norman Foster, world famous architect, to African kids who probably have seen nature, I suppose, right? But this is something that that's unique to Singapore, and something for Singaporeans to be very proud of. I'm really proud of what NParks has achieved over the 50 years. It's unique, and actually with this very good foundation, I really believe we can achieve so much more. Thank you.
Thank you. Your comment, I mean, it's about, I'll start with the rain tree, and I promise I won't go that long, but it just, there is about things that we build or make, and then you can calculate the loading on a building or on a bridge or something. I think there's a little bit something known about it. We have engineering solutions too, but I do think for things like trees and animals, wildlife, there's a kind of an unpredictability about it. And I promise I will talk about your rain trees, and which makes it difficult sometimes to convince other people to feel that view. And I'll give you the example at Admiralty Park, was it just a month or two ago, very tragic accident where a rain tree failed, and it happened sadly, tragically, to kill a young man who had a bright future to look forward to, and everything, with dreams, family, the whole lot. And it was a tragedy, but then you did hear then all of a sudden people calling for national parks to, what are we doing with all these big trees? This is a danger. And so a monkey bites a child or maims a dog, and then now it's call AVA and let's get rid of these monkeys. And it's this very, it's a real challenge. How do you maintain this objective view about things, but also try to keep in mind this public safety and these, and how do we not overreact to this? Honestly, the chances of dying of a shark bite or snake bite or stonefish are so much less than, you know, crossing the street. But there's that element of the unknown about it that makes it kind of terrifying. And so, when there's a storm, when there's an accident, when there's, you know, wildlife run amok a little bit, or you know, where do we? How do we keep this conversation a tempered and even, to the extent possible, a rational one? And I think, in a way, aesthetically, a rain tree is wonderful, and I totally agree with you, and it supports wildlife, and civets like to eat the fruits and everything. But then, what do we do when that rain tree falls on somebody? And then how do we keep the argument going? Which is, and a solution not to cut them all down, but to, you know, to take a deep breath, a step back, and think, what's the overall benefit? Nature, greenery, how does it make it a special place?
Thank you. I think you will agree that we are both citizens and residents living here indeed much blessed by the fact that we have so much greenery and 50 years of it. The greenery story of Singapore is really one of my favorite cases. I teach it with pride to both the civil servants as well as to business leaders. My interest in the green story is also about the governance part of it, which I think we have addressed. But there were some, let me end by perhaps a few takeaways for myself, and I think we can also take heart to it. If you look at the development of greenery, 50 years ago, 1963, where Singapore was at, there's no logic to it. Without a leader with a strong conviction, this thing wouldn't have happened. And I think that will continue to be true even today in many other areas. If we follow only the trends of the day, we will never achieve greatness in any of our policy areas. Secondly, if you look at the early developments, particularly in the 60s and 70s, and even the 80s, where we have a great vision given by the Prime Minister at that time, but really we were learning by doing. experimentally. Mistakes, I think Hong Yuen talked about. Those that doesn't work, stop. Those that work, do. That's pragmatic, purposeful experimentation. And that has laid a tremendous groundwork for our subsequent ability to exploit that further through a city in the garden, through the green plan, and through others. And I think we must not forget that in many of our policy areas that we have very little experience and knowledge, we probably would have to take the same approach and not to trust too much in formal plans and procedures which we may not know. Thirdly, we find that a vision, an achievement like this cannot happen without the institution and a set of institutions behind it. And that's why I wanted Hong Yuen to describe a bit about the NPARC and its predecessor. But it's not just about NPARCs. It's a URA. It is a PUB, the ABC Water Project. It is a LTA. It is the whole set of government institutions working together that I think allowed us to achieve what we did. It's not just a single individual. Lee Kuan Yew by himself would not be able to do this, even though he had a vision. But a set of institutions that I think have carried us through and continues to be really what will allow us to make even greater achievements. And finally, if you look at what we can achieve with very limited resources, and I believe Hong Yuen, when he says that even today NParks is under-resourced, they have been under-resourced for 50 years and continue to be. But look at the achievements. Look at what we have, what we are able to enjoy as citizens and as residents here. Look at the amount of innovation and creativity that has come out, despite the fact that we are under-resourced. That throwing money at problems alone may not always be the answer. Working with NGOs in the 70s was probably not such a good idea. Being a civil servant, they did it. Working with the community when it was not such a buzzword at the time, but being with deep conviction, passion, and despite the fact that there were not enough resources, pull together, work with whoever can put their effort, their money as well, providing donations and giving us the kind of environment that we have and the quality of life that we have here in Singapore. Please join me to thank our panelists, Dr. Chua, Mr. Poon, and Simon, Sean, for their wonderful presentation and comments.
Thank you, Dr. Chua, Mr. Poon, and Dr. Lum, for sharing your insights and experiences with us. And thank you, Prof. Neil, for moderating the session. We would now like to invite Mr. Koo, the Executive Director of CLC, to present the panelists with a token of appreciation. Mr. Koo, please. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of our lecture. We thank you for your participation today, and we look forward to seeing you again next month for our upcoming lecture on Singapore's tourism development.